Oh, thank you. Very kind. Thank you. My name is Nick DeBerardino. I'm a composer. I'm the director of composition studies here at Curtis and the director of Ensemble 2021. I'm thrilled that you all are here tonight. This is our first Ensemble 2021 concert since the very beginning of the pandemic. And right? It's so nice to have such a great crowd, and we're so excited to share these performances with you of music from the 20th and 21st centuries. So tonight, we have an interesting opportunity afforded to us by the pandemic, namely that we had two concerts planned for this semester initially, and we've rolled two concert themes into one, so you get to hear a bit of both tonight. So on the one hand, some of the pieces on tonight's program are a celebration of our all-school project this year at Curtis, which is Music of Change. This is music that celebrates the intersection between art and broader society, and in particular, the fight for justice. So a few of the pieces on the concert tonight are along those lines. And a few of the pieces on the concert tonight celebrate composers with deep Philadelphia roots, which was our Celebrating Penn Composers concert. So this evening, we will first hear a piece by Stephen Jaffe, which is a really scintillating solo guitar work. That'll be our concert opener. Stephen Jaffe was a alumnus of Penn, and the piece was commissioned by our very own David Starobin, who's here tonight, so we have a nice double connection there. We'll then move into a string quartet by RHIANNON GIDDENS, and this piece fits our Music of Change theme. The piece is called At the Purchaser's Option, and the title comes from an advertisement that RHIANNON GIDDENS found in a 19th century newspaper for the sale of a slave. After that piece, we move into the work which is responsible for this gorgeous battery of percussion behind me. And this is going to be a performance of George Crumb's percussion quintet, Chronos Kryptos. This is actually George Crumb's first piece for percussion ensemble, although it was the second to last piece that he completed before he died. And it's just a true honor to present it to you tonight. I'll say a few words of thanks about that, some of the people who helped to make it happen right after you hear that piece. Closing out the concert tonight is a world premiere that we're very excited about that was done in collaboration between Curtis and the Purple Project for Democracy. Professor Jerry Wind is here tonight, who helped put this whole thing together. I'd say he was the mastermind, the genius behind the operation. So we're very excited for that. We have two guest artists with us tonight who are going to tell you a bit about the work before you hear it. We'll have a bit of like a long stage change as we bring all this percussion gear backstage, and we'll introduce the guest artists to you then. So I only have two more things to say to you before you enjoy the concert. The first is, if you wouldn't mind keeping your masks on during this performance, that would be in accordance with our school policy, and we would appreciate it. The second thing, and I'm going to do this with you now, is we'd love if you would take out your phones and make sure they don't make noise. So I like to go for airplane mode, but do as you will. With that, I hope you enjoy tonight's Ensemble 2021 concert. Thank you very much. Thank you. Now we'll have a big stage change. But while we do, I want to say a few words of thanks. Thank you in particular to David and Becky Sterabin for inspiring this CRUMB project. A huge thank you to Bob Van Sice and Don Liuzzi for all their work coaching our phenomenal percussion studio on this work. I want to say thank you also to Chris Devinny and Peabody Conservatory, without whom we could not have assembled this wonderful collection of instruments in the first place. While I'm saying thank yous, I'll say thank you also to our production team, including Justin Bowen, who's running house, also Jessica Wolfer. Thank you to our AV team, including Chris Frey on the lights, Drew Schlegel on audio, Matt Hagesten, who's running our video capture, and also Brian Ryder, who helped us to organize that side of the evening. So, with those thank yous having been said, I would like to now invite up our two guest artists, Alexis Lamb and Camilla Tassi, who are here with us tonight. Where are you two? Are you still here somewhere? Join me in welcoming them. Hi, Camilla.
Yeah, hi.
Hi, Alexis.
Hello.
Hello.
Okay, everyone can hear you, yes?
I think so.
So far, so good.
Okay, good. Well, it's such a pleasure to have you both here with us tonight.
Thank you.
And I'm excited to speak with you both about this piece that you created together. And so I think before we get into that, I would like to ask each of you a little bit about yourselves as artists, because we have you here, so we might as well learn about that. Alexis, why don't we start with you? Tell us something about your musical background and how you got to this place tonight.
Sure. I am originally from Denver, Colorado. I am a percussionist. That actually my first percussion instructor is here tonight, so what's up? Thanks for being here. I did my undergraduate work at Northern Illinois University, where I studied percussion performance and music education. I went on to teach middle and high school band for a short period of time, and then I did my master's at the Yale School of Music in composition, and that's where I met Camilla. So she and I worked on a project together first a few years ago at this point, pre-pandemic, and I'm really happy to be back here with her tonight.
Camilla, how about you?
I come from Florence, Italy, and I moved to the States in 2005. My formal background is in computer science and music as a vocalist, but I then went on to Hanover, New Hampshire to study sort of technology and music, and then met Alexis at Yale, where I'm at the School of Drama finishing up, and I'm so thankful Alexis found this project and that we got a chance to collaborate again.
Yeah.
I was going to ask about that, actually. How did you find this project? And can you tell us a little bit about what this project has meant to both of you?
Sure. I was just looking. There's a collection of different sites for composition opportunities, different collaborations, different calls for scores, sort of write-in submissions for things. And I saw this as a collaborative opportunity right after the time that Camilla and I had done our music and video project together. And I really wanted to work with her again, and there was a lot that was very intriguing to me about the idea of combining music with another artistic element and being able to talk about important issues such as democracy and where we're at.
I like this idea of having like wind chimes that happen during concerts. I think that's kind of nice, actually. So that's interesting, and I wanted to kind of just spotlight this for a second for everyone. From what I understand, this project had to do with promoting democratic values. I think that's something that the Purple Project for Democracy is really interested in. So, Camilla, could you tell us a little bit about how this project that you have put together kind of intersects with that mission?
Sure, and this was really in collaboration and in conversation with Alexis, but I will speak, I guess, to the visual side of it, which was primarily informed from the music. But a lot of the imagery you will see, most of the imagery you see, comes from peaceful protests, and we actually reached out to our community, our respective communities, and had people submit materials that they were comfortable with us sharing and utilizing in the piece, as well as, you know, the way we're interacting with those pieces of footage or still imagery is using some like live elements, whether that's sound or video, which kind of ties into what Alexis is doing with some of the improvisation. But yeah, you know, it was, I don't know, these last few years especially in this country have been like incredibly shaped by these questions and by like what it means to not only like stand up for what people like believe is like equitable and just, but also how do we approach it and how do we live with it also.
Yeah, I think to echo that, a lot of the material, so you'll hear sort of a collage of different musical and spoken elements along the way. A lot of the spoken material is sourced from similar interactions with people, experiences in protests or sort of grassroots campaigning. And I also was doing a lot of research about why we were protesting these things in the first place. That was really important. As well as researching different Supreme Court cases that dealt with First Amendment rights in particular. And then finally, the piece is dedicated to Ruth Bader Ginsburg. And throughout the piece, you'll hear a song that I wrote for her the night that she passed away. And that's sort of the core of the work as an homage and as a point of kind of hopefulness moving forward.
Great. And can you tell us a little bit more, Alexis, about, I know this piece involves a lot of text.
It does.
And so when we start hearing this thing, what are we going to experience and what is the text that we're going to be hearing?
Sure. So again, a lot of the text in the very beginning of the piece is different protest calls from a number of active protests that have happened, particularly in the last 5 years or so. That will come and go over time. It'll be usually accompanied with some clapping as well, trying to evoke, along with the visuals of really what it feels like to be part of those protests. And again, you will have kind of these spoken interjections throughout of statements from deciding Supreme Court cases on rights to freedom of political expression, particularly in public schools. And then again, the song that you'll hear throughout, you'll hear that text at the very end.
So. Camilla, I've been in rehearsal this week, so I've had a chance to see this, and it's sounding and looking great. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing with visuals? I know that there's some elements that are live in the room, which I think is sort of interesting.
Yeah.
Could you tell us more about that?
So there's sort of two live elements. One of them is sort of responding to audio, and particularly responding to the kick drum. So we have some live reacting audio visuals, and another part of it is just live feed camera video of particularly the conductor, just incorporated. And I wanted to also like explore layering as the musical piece sort of gets more chaotic or gets layered with different instruments, exploring that parallel visually.
So when we all hear this piece and we have this experience together, is there any particular feeling that you hope you'll have evoked for us in the experience?
Mm-hmm. I hope that it brings conversation, that people from any political side can come together and talk about their experiences and their relationship to democracy and what they hope to see with it moving forward in a way that does bring an element of community rather than talking over each other. You're talking with each other.
How about you, Camilla?
Yeah, I completely agree with Alexis. And I'm also curious, you know, what people will resonate with and what they will, you know, if it's like some of the, there's some like quieter moments and some more solitary moments, and then also, you know, some more like chaotic, kind of overwhelming moments. And so just curious how that's gonna resonate differently with people.
So one more thing I want to ask you each is, did you like working with such a specific kind of theme in mind? And are you planning another project together? We'll start with you, Alexis.
Yes, I did. I think that the project, it doesn't seem as limiting as it might by giving a topic to start, because there are so many different directions that you could go with that topic. And so it was just sort of like a guiding track along the way to figure out what material I wanted to use and how is going to piece the collage together along the way. I really hope that we can work together on another project. I'm looking forward
same.
To it, whenever the next opportunity is.
Yeah, it was fun that this one incorporated also like a specific instrumentation, and I love that. And I'm with you that sometimes, like, the constraint actually, like, allow you to get more creative about what you have in front of you.
Is there anything else you want us to know about the piece before we hear it?
We're going to hear it more than once.
Well, right? I will, yes. We are. So it's a fine time to say that. So I was going to say a special thank you again to Professor Jerry Wynn for giving us this opportunity to co-present this world premiere with the Purple Project for Democracy. As a special thank you, I hope you don't know this yet, Jerry, we're planning on performing this piece twice. And there are a few reasons why I really believe in doing this. One is that as a composer, it's always frustrating when you put all this work into creating a piece, and then it only happens once and everyone leaves. And a lot of what we experience when we experience music that we know and are familiar with is that we experience the whole trajectory of the piece, and knowing a little bit about what's going to happen next helps us, I think, enjoy the piece more fully. So you'll have a chance to hear the broad shape of the work and think about how it's impacted you, and then you'll get to know it a little better by hearing it a second time. Another reason why I think it's nice to do this is as a kind of commitment, kind of a statement about Curtis's belief in these ideas in this piece and in engaging with the democratic process. So yes, we're going to hear the piece twice.
Awesome.
Glad you mentioned it.
Wonderful.
Yes. And when it ends, you know, we can give a round of applause, and then they'll go straight into it again, and that'll close out the show.
Maybe.
Anything else?
No. Thank you all for being here. I'm happy to talk with you after and start those conversations with you along the way. Thank you. And thank you again.
Oh, yes. Thank you both for being here. We're so excited to hear the piece.
Yeah.
I'm going to let you get set up. Thank you so much. And as we're putting together the final touches on the stage here behind me, I do want to read for you some words from David Ludwig. This project began a number of years ago. I can't remember how many, but it was before the pandemic. And David Ludwig was a big part of putting this project together. And so he wanted me to share some words with you all tonight before you hear this piece. And I promised him that I would read them faithfully, so I'm going to actually read them to you. So here's what David wants to say to us all. He says, "I've been asked to write a note to acknowledge my own role in tonight's presentation, since I am on the West Coast and can't be there in person. I'm grateful to have the opportunity. It feels like a lifetime ago that we started to talk about the Purple Project Commission with Professor Jerry Wynn. Nick DiBerardino and I put a panel of outside judges together, well-known composers in the field, and they chose the composer Alexis Lamb to receive the prize. Though I am no longer on faculty at Curtis, as an alum, I couldn't be more excited to see all of its accomplishments this year as we come out of the pandemic, as well as the continued investment in contemporary music at the school. This very much includes Nick DiBerardino's role carrying the new music torch at Curtis, which I'm sure is awkward for him to say. Yes, it is. But he agreed to read this note in its entirety. We are reminded every day of the importance of the Purple Project's values and how fragile democracy really is. All congratulations then to Jerry, Nick, Ensemble 2021, and especially to Alexis and Camilla on this exciting premiere tonight. So thank you all, and I hope you enjoy Tell Me What Democracy Looks Like by Alexis Lamb and Camilla Tassi.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.